busboy asked for the money, the employers just said, we're not going to give it to you. So what are you going to do? You're going to leave?
You thought restaurant work was a good job? Well, think again. I'm David Bacon, co-host of the Labor Report on KPFA's morning show. Next week, you'll hear Pakwai, Tam, and other restaurant workers tell you what it's really like. Sexual harassment, the special rules in Chinatown, the lowdown on why workers don't get breaks even before our governor tried to take them away. Young Workers United, up against the Cheesecake Factory trying to make restaurant work a decent job. Tune in every morning this week except Thursday at 8:08. Hear what it's like putting San Francisco's gourmet food on the table from the people who do the work.
And you are listening to KPFA in Berkeley, KPFB in Berkeley, and KFCF in Fresno. The time is 1 o'clock. Stay tuned next for Terra Verde.
From the Amazon basin, from the magnificent redwoods of California to the icy majesty of the Arctic, life on Earth faces an unprecedented threat from careless development. Join Terra Verde over lunch today to find out about the unfolding future of the planet.
Welcome to Terra Verde, a weekly environmental radio show on KPFA or KPFB in Berkeley or KFCF in Fresno. My name is Michelle Chan Fischel, and today we're being joined by a new host on Terra Verde, Adrienne Fitch-Frankel.
Hello. Today we are speaking with a couple of environmental advocates to hear their predictions of the biggest environmental developments of 2005. With us in the studio is Doug Linney, president of The Next Generation, a consulting firm serving environmental advocacy campaigns. And joining us on the phone is Sarah Stebb, legislative director of Friends of the Earth U.S. Welcome.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thanks.
Before we look forward to 2005, let's take a look back at something that happened in 2004 that some expect to have a major impact on 2005. George Bush was reelected to a second term in office as president of the United States. What does that mean for the environment?
It's obviously very disappointing in the results of the United States and the results of the election. And I think it means that in the short term that we have to look to the states to do a lot of the environmental heavy lifting that we do to protect the environment and to push new policies forward. Thanks.
And Sarah?
I think Doug is absolutely right, but I also think we need to be clear about one thing. The fact that George Bush was reelected in no way gives him a mandate for his anti-environmental agenda. And in fact, if you look at some of the top issues that voters at the national level listed, they cited things such as the economy and the war on terror. But if you take a closer look at elections at the state and local level where voters had an opportunity to cast a vote directly on the environment overwhelmingly won. And I would point to things such as ballot initiatives in states such as Colorado and Montana and other areas that went predominantly for George Bush, where you had voters going out to the polls and casting their votes in favor of things like renewable energy.
And so what about the Senate? Now we have more Republicans in the Senate, increasing their majority. Does that mean that in the Congress we're also going to be seeing some environmental rollbacks?
We certainly, the political climate at the federal level in D.C. didn't improve during the past election, but we've been facing some pretty difficult odds for the past 4 years. And certainly not to make things sound a lot better than they are, but I do think that the environmental community has learned a lot of important lessons over the past 4 years that we're going to apply to our campaigns in the coming years. And we certainly expect to see an onslaught of anti-environmental legislation in the Congress and also a continued attempt by the administration to roll back important regulations. But we will hopefully continue to have some of the success that we've had during the past 4 years in defeating some of these initiatives.
I'd like to ask each of you to tell us what you think will be the top 3 to 5 environmental issues in 2005. Please start by sharing with us your list of top issues, and we'll come back to explore some of these issues in depth after we have heard from each of you. Sarah, what will our listeners be reading in the morning papers this year? What will be the top environmental issues of 2005?
Well, I think when it comes to federal environmental policy, certainly energy is going to be one of the top issues. I think also, in general, the issue of regulatory attacks on environmental safeguards, particularly clean air and clean water. And then finally, I would also point to protections for endangered species as an issue that we'll probably be hearing a lot about in the coming year.
And what about, Doug, in California or otherwise, what do you think are going to be the biggest environmental issues?
Well, I think one of our biggest challenges is always going to be even just making sure that we are in the paper. This is, it's one of those issues that with all the other things, especially at the national level with the Iraq war and everything, that gets pushed out. And it's one of the issues that I think if we're not careful, Bush and his friends will be able to roll back things and attack the environment in ways that we won't even know about or most people won't know about. But in California, the key issues, I think, I would agree, certainly energy is going to be one of the top ones. There's a list that I'd like to see have happen, and then I think there's the list that I think is going to just have to be there. And energy and global warming are certainly in the top of my list of things that we need to deal with. And the other one, it would be doing something about growth related to housing, related to transportation. California adds about 500,000 new Californians every year. We're just not planning for that growth in any kind of meaningful way, and so we're ending up with sprawl. We're paving over agricultural lands, losing potential habitat or current habitat for animals, and we need to deal with that right now. But I would say the overriding issue that we're going to see in California is the budget and the effects that has on the environment with the impacts on reductions in resources, protection in purchase of resources, and just the attention again to the environment. It's an issue that again can be cut at the state level if we let them get away with it.
So we're seeing land use, budget issues, energy stuff, and also certainly seeing energy stuff in terms of national issues. I wanted to go back to something that you had mentioned, sir, with respect to the Endangered Species Act. You said that, and that was going to be a key issue coming up for environmentalists this year. If you could just explain for us quickly what, and very, very quickly, what the Endangered Species Act is and what you think is going to be happening.
Sure. Well, the Endangered Species Act is basically our law that helps protect and helps protect threatened and endangered species, and in fact helps these species recover. One of the important things is that it doesn't just help protect the species themselves, but it requires that their habitat be protected. And one result of this is that by helping provide healthy ecosystems for species, the law also benefits people by helping provide things like clean water and clean air and by preserving the natural heritage that we have for future generations. What we have seen over the past few years is lawmakers in Congress who are hostile to this law talk about the fact that they wanted to really overhaul it. And Congressman Richard Pombo from California, who is the chair of the committee in the House of Representatives that has jurisdiction over this issue, has made it very clear that that taking up the Endangered Species Act is going to be one of his top priorities this year.
And if you could also give us a sense of the other environmental rollbacks you had mentioned we might expect.
Well, the Endangered Species Act is something that we expect Congress to be really pushing. But I do think that another big theme that we'll see this year is the Bush administration attempting to use the regulatory process to weaken environmental laws that have been on the books for, in many cases, three decades or more. And they do this because federal regulations are difficult to follow. They don't receive the same type of scrutiny that that the laws that Congress debates receives. And as a result, they feel like they can use these regulations to weaken environmental laws in a way that the public won't really understand. And a couple of examples one key example that could have impacts on California is the issue of mercury. And here you have the Bush administration attempting to downgrade mercury from a hazardous air pollutant, even though scientists, including the National Academy of Sciences, have broadly said that mercury causes neurological damage in children and developing fetuses. And so we expect the Bush administration to continue pushing regulatory proposal that that is not as strong as the EPA's own scientists say is possible using current technology.
Doug, would you like to weigh in on this, this issue?
You know, I'm interested. In California, we've been a leader in passing environmental legislation. And we have our own Clean Air Act. We have our own Clean Water Act. 2 years ago, or a year ago, we passed the Pavley bill to start taking the lead on the issue of global warming. And I think the concern is that at the federal level, we can also see some rollbacks on states' rights or some efforts to try and keep states from instituting their own stricter environmental laws. I'm just curious, Sarah, whether you see that as an issue also that could happen.
I absolutely do, and I think that you raise a really interesting point for a couple of reasons. I mean, one is the fact that at a time that you have the Bush administration and Congress in many cases attempting to roll back the clock on environmental protection, here you have states like California and others that are really blazing the trail for a more forward-thinking type of environmental protection. And energy is a perfect example. You mentioned the Pavley bill. So here we have California attempting to regulate tailpipe emissions at the same time that you have a Congress that refuses to do anything about fuel economy. So going back to one of your opening comments, I think it's absolutely true that in the coming few years, we can expect the states to really lead the way in a number of these areas. And with respect to your question right now, I also think that there is indeed a big danger that both the Bush administration and Congress may try to throw up roadblocks in front of California and other states who are attempting to protect the environment on their own.
Doug, what are the implications of the national energy policy that Sarah's been talking about for California's environment?
Well, in California, one of the priorities for our energy policy is to increase our renewables. We passed legislation again a couple years ago to pass a renewable portfolio standard, which sets goals for the state to be able to increase its use of renewables and decrease our dependence on foreign oil and on natural gas as our main sources of energy. We're very encouraged in a lot of ways that this governor has said when he was running that solar energy was going to be a big part of things. He supports the renewable portfolio standards. We've been pushing him to increase those goals even further than they are. But he ran on a promise of 50% of new homes would be solar powered that would be built. And again, when we're adding 500,000 new people a year to California, that could be a very significant contribution. So I think our goals here are really to hold the governor to his promises and to push to increase the use of renewable energy in California.
Do you think Schwarzenegger himself sees himself in California as playing the role of the bellwether state, playing the role as the, you know, defense against national environmental rollbacks? I mean, certainly in the environmental community, we see California is playing that role. What about the governor himself?
I think he's still having a hard time figuring out what kind of Republican he is. You know, he'll support Bush on a lot of things, but he also doesn't seem to be afraid to oppose Bush on other things. You know, there's been some things where he's gone out on his own to lobby the Bush administration to not do some of the environmental things, the bad things that they were going to do, and others where he's disappointed us and hasn't taken those steps. So I think without any doubt, we have a real opportunity here, though, in having a governor who knows these issues, who's not ideologically opposed to them. We have a Democratic legislature that can pass things. So we might be quite surprised at some of the positive things that we can do. What was disappointing, though, was that in his State of the State address just 2 nights ago, there was no mention of the environment in any significant way, certainly no positive issues brought up there. And I was very disappointed to see that because I'd really like to see this be a priority of his administration.
Sarah, we were talking a little earlier about how the Congress, Senate has, on the national level, has become more Republican. Are there also environmental leaders amongst the Republicans on the federal level?
Oh, there absolutely are. And I think certainly California at the state level has always been a great example of the fact that the environment is not and should not be a partisan issue. So at the same time that you have folks like Governor Schwarzenegger at the state level taking on some of these tough issues, you have people like Senator John McCain from Arizona, who has been one of our top leaders on the issue of climate change in the Senate, in addition to many other environmental champions on the Republican side of the aisle. And so certainly as we deal with issues like energy and some of these attempts to roll back environmental laws, we will be working just as closely with Republican members of Congress as we will be with Democrats, and that's the way it should be.
This is Michelle Chan Fischel with my co-host Ian Fitch Frankel, and you're tuned to Terra Verde, a weekly environmental radio show on KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno. You're listening to the voices of Sarah Stebb, Legislative Director at Friends of the Earth U.S. You're also joined in the studio by Doug Linney, President of the Next Generation. Doug, you had mentioned a little bit before that that budget is going to seriously be the huge dominant issue, as it was last year. And certainly it made it into the State of the State address. Tell us a little bit about where you think the environment is going to fare in the whole budget situation.
Well, it's obviously really hard to tell. What we do know is that the budget's also an opportunity to reform some of the things that we have problems with, too. I mean, I've been the author in the last 4 years of a report called Green Watchdog that looks at ways that the state government can basically make polluters pay. And at the same time, it raises revenues. It also discourages the bad behavior that happens with pollution and stuff. And we think there's a lot of opportunities to raise revenues, to cut pollution at the same time. And we're hoping the governor can take advantage of this. We have a new governor still, and new opportunities to take advantage of that.
And actually, any similar efforts on the national level, Sarah?
Yeah, in fact, I think that some of the challenges Doug just raised are happening at the federal level as well, both in terms of budget cuts to programs that protect the environment and in terms of the opportunity that decision makers have to cut wasteful spending that hurts the environment. Certainly, we have seen over the past 4 years an attempt by the administration to push through really harmful cuts to programs that protect our air, our water, that help clean up toxic waste sites, that help protect our public lands. And as the administration continues to push through additional tax cuts, to face challenges in terms of, you know, everything from funding the war in Iraq to providing assistance to victims of the tsunami disaster, we're going to continue to see programs such as the environment squeezed. And I would, for example, point to a recent bill that Congress passed funding all of the federal agencies where not only did the environment get cut, but it got cut in a really disproportionate way. And this has been kind of a trend that we've seen in the Bush administration's budget the past several years. Many, many programs get cut on a range of issues, but the environment frequently gets singled out for disproportionately punitive cuts. And that is absolutely going to be something that we're fighting this year.
So 2005, is it going to be all bad news on the environment? Are environmentalists only going to be able to play the defensive side this year? Or are there any possibilities for going on the offensive?
Well, like I say, at the state level, I think there's, if we remain optimistic, we do have a governor who was elected with a very aggressive environmental, list of environmental promises. And if we can hold him to those promises, I think we could do well. And with a very environmental oriented legislature with still plenty of exceptions, I think there's plenty to be optimistic about. And it's always good to be optimistic at the beginning of the year anyway. We're looking at some forestry reform. We're looking at, like I said, the transportation housing possibilities, the solar possibilities of increasing support for renewables. So I think there's, and then finally the global warming. There is Assemblywoman Pavley is looking at introducing some new legislation that would put cap and trade restrictions on carbon in California.
And before we get into a little bit more of those, Sarah, your take being in D.C., is it really all bad news?
I think at the federal level, certainly we are going to be playing a lot of defense. But as I said, we have learned a lot over the past 4 years. We have beaten back attempts to pass a terrible energy bill. We've stopped We stopped other pieces of legislation that would hurt the environment. And so while we will be on the defense, I'm confident that we're going to continue to see victories. But I do agree with Doug that over the next few years, at least, we can probably expect a lot of the more proactive attempts to protect the environment to really come from the ground up at the state level.
And Doug, if we can get back to your, you had flagged for us just previously that we have some opportunities in transportation, in land use, in all these areas. Go into a little bit more detail for us.
Well, one in particular I'd like to talk about is the global warming. And that's the big issue. Just the latest issue of Economist had England's Prime Minister saying, who's now the head of the G8, saying that global warming is one of the two biggest issues the G8 has to deal with, and cited California's example as one of the things that shows that the United States hasn't completely written off this issue. We're basically the only country that hasn't taken any kind of significant action, but California being the sixth or seventh largest economy, there's a lot that we can do. So there's proposals being looked at to basically take a lot of the concepts from the McCain-Lieberman bill and use them here in California. And, you know, there'll always be problems with preemption and how do we do it here, but we think that we can get around a lot of those, and that the time that we showed that we could do it once before in California, it's time to do it again, and that we have the backing of the rest of the country and the environmentalists to get something done like this.
Sam, sometimes we hear, and we've already spoken about this a little bit on the program, I wanted to tease it out a little bit further, that California is seen as an environmental leader. How exactly does that work, you know, within the federal legislature or in other states? How do other parts of the country look to California for leadership and integrate our policies into a broader spectrum of policies?
Well, I mean, I think on some of these energy issues are a perfect example. You've seen California really leading the way, and then other states such as New York and others quickly kind of picking up that mantle and taking action on their own on things like fuel efficiency and the use of renewable energy. And so certainly our hope is that on a range of energy and environmental issues that other states will continue to follow California's lead, and that ultimately this will lead a Congress and an administration that is not currently very friendly to our issues to take a second look and to adopt a more pro-environment approach.
So you're saying that the way California's leadership gets exported, if you will, is by other states, A, copying us, and B, it having some kind of political reverberation on the national level. But Doug, you had mentioned that there could be some sort of preemption. How does that exactly work? How does the U.S. Congress or the federal government actually end up putting a stop to what happens here in the United States? Here in California.
Yeah, well, there's right now certain laws. I'm not an expert on this, but preemption in terms of trade, interstate trade, and the ability to do that. And I think, you know, Congress can pass any law at once. It can pass laws that says that you know, it will be the purview of only the federal government to deal with all issues dealing with carbon emissions or something like that. I mean, they could pass something like that that would make it much more difficult for us to do things at the state level, despite the fact that, general conservative doctrine is that states' rights. But we found when it comes to the environment, there's not very much consistency there. So I think that's a concern that we could have, particularly if we get very militant about this.
I think that's absolutely right. And I think those of us working on environmental policy at the federal level very much need to be on guard for attempts to sneak language into bills that are moving through Congress that would prevent states like California and others from taking steps to protect the environment on their own. And frequently what you'll see happen is a particular member of Congress who is close with a particular industry or special interest sneak some language into a bill at the 11th hour, which in effect rolls back or blocks attempts to protect the environment. And so we will certainly be on guard here in D.C. for attempts to do that.
You've both given us some really fascinating insights into what are likely to be the most prominent environmental issues of 2005. But will it be any big untold stories in 2005? Will there be major developments that fly underneath most people's radar screens? Doug?
I'm not sure about untold, but plenty of unexpected, I think we can, you start at the beginning of the year, you're optimistic, and you kind of look, have a clean slate for certain things, and you want to predict and have certain things happen. But politics is really about opportunity, and when circumstances dictate it, whether, you know, there's a gas shortage or electricity problems or, a big oil spill, those present both, again, opportunities and to improve things, or could be a disaster if we're unprepared. All of a sudden, gas prices shoot up and people panic about where they're going to get their gasoline and stuff like that. So, we always have to be ready for the unexpected.
And Sarah?
I think, I don't know that it's so much an untold story. It's something that I think might surprise people who follow environmental issues, but I do think that we'll continue to see an emerging bipartisan majority, if you will, in Congress, starting to fight back against some of the Bush administration's more harmful environmental proposals. For example, you have Christy Whitman, the former EPA administrator, releasing a book where she is going to complain about the way that she feels her party has been captured by more conservative forces, and really arguing that there's a place in the middle for Republicans who care about the environment, among other issues. So I think whether the issue is energy or mercury or endangered species, we're really going to look to Republicans as well as traditional Democrats to fight back against some of these harmful proposals.
Well, I can't wait to read Christine Tell Whitman's new book. It should be quite juicy reading. Well, I wanted to go ahead and wrap up this story by being able to give both of you guys a chance to answer this question. In light of all of these important environmental issues at stake this year, whether we're talking about mercury, whether we're talking budget, et cetera, if you were to ask our KPFA listeners to make one environmental New Year's resolution, so to speak, what would it be, Doug?
I think it would be don't give up. I mean, it was a very discouraging election year, and it's easy to just kind of throw the towel in and say it doesn't work. But there's a lot of things that can be done at the state level, a lot of things that need to be done at the federal level to stop the damage. And I would urge everyone, as always, to make a resolution to get involved. And California League of Conservation Voters is a great state organization to get involved with. Their website is ecovote.org, and I urge you to sign up, get involved.
Sarah?
I could not agree more. I think one of the really encouraging things coming out of this election was the millions of new voters, including young people who got engaged for the very first time. And we need to make sure that those folks remain engaged. And so if I could encourage people to do one thing, it would be to stay involved by contacting their member of Congress and their senators. Obviously, listeners in California are fortunate to have senators like Barbara Boxer and Dianne Feinstein, who are very good environmental champions. But even if getting involved simply means sending a letter to say thanks, it's important to do that as well. So write, call, fax your member of Congress.
Great. And really quickly, we'd like to be able to give out some contact details. Doug, if you could give the web and phone coordinates for Next Generation.
Next Generation is at nextgeneration.org, and you can reach us at 444-4710.
That's nextgeneration.org, area code 510-444-4710. And you also said EcoVote is the website for the League of Conservation Voters in California. Sarah?
You can find Friends of the Earth on the web at www.foe.org. And you can call us toll-free at 1-877-843-8687.
And that is FOE.org, which is the website, and 877-843-8687 is the website, is the telephone number where you can go to. That's all the time we have for today's show. Thank you so much, Doug and Sarah, for joining us, and to Erica Bridgman for being our engineer. This show and others are available from kpfa.org for your convenience. Have a great weekend.
Global warming, war, sprawl, such are the legacy of fossil fuels, the power source for a global economic system that has brought prosperity to some at the expense of many. Now that fossil fuels are reaching their limits, what needs to be done? You are invited to a benefit conversation on California's renewable energy future and community action with Paul Fenn of Local Power, Rory Cost of Pacific Environment, and Dave Broom of Post Carbon Institute, moderated by former PUC Commissioner Loretta Lynch, the Ecology Center in Berkeley, January 20th, 7 to 9 p.m., $10 donation, info line 510-548-2220.